Hi, everyone. It's Coach Stefan Rudolph coming to you from beautiful Escondido, California out here, enjoying the sun, enjoying the life. And we're once again having a great podcast interview. We have a special guest with us. Now, our group itself is The Healthy Way, and that is Holistic Epilepsy Awareness and Loving, Transforming, and Healing Yourself. And we help people out there with epilepsy, with seizures, and basically with life coaching in general. I've been an author and a speaker for about 7 years now, and overcame epilepsy myself, overcame brain surgery, alcoholism, and addiction. And thought about this idea earlier this year, came together with Liz Nichols and Stacy Chalimi here, and we've been doing a great podcast to help others be inspired out there. So I want to introduce Stacy here. Stacy, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing great, and how are you?
Doing great. Beautiful Escondido out here. Lovely Hidden Valley.
Looks great over there. I'm a little jealous. You know, on the East Coast, we don't get all those beautiful weather and those trees like you guys do over here.
Yeah, we got the mountains and the valleys and everything else out here.
We do got a lot of heat this week.
Yeah, we went through that last week. So the ups and downs, the mountains in life, the heat in life, that's kind of what we're here for, to hear more stories. And Stacy can talk a little bit about herself here and then introduce our special guest.
Oh, that sounds great. Well, my name is Stacy, and I'm a health coach, a life coach, and an epilepsy coach. I developed epilepsy at the age of 5, and I had lived a very challenging life. And I have dedicated my life to helping others with epilepsy. I've written over 20 books, and I'm the founder of the Complete Herbal Guide. I work with a lot of people, teaching them how to heal their body naturally and how to change their lifestyle so they can improve their overall health and also help their epilepsy, through natural healing and through changes in my lifestyle and using medication. I was able to control my seizures, and I've written a book recently called Empower Yourself, Don't Let Your Conditions Empower You. I'm very much into trying to teach people how to empower themselves so they can reach their goals. And I also I've written a book about epilepsy, You're Not Alone, to show people that you're not the only one, that there are millions of people worldwide with epilepsy. And we have a beautiful person today that I'm very excited to introduce to you. Her name is Cheryl, and she has epilepsy, and she's here to tell her story and give helpful advice. And then she's going to tell you how you can contact her later on if you have any questions. And she's just an absolute wonderful person with an amazing story to tell. And I'd like to put it over to you, Cheryl.
Hi there. Good morning. Very nice to be here with you all. We have nice sunny skies here too in Chill Rock, BC. Beautiful weather. So it all started for me back when I was just finishing university in 1977. And I had just watched a friend play hockey in April. And I was heading over to the university to finish some projects. And I was following this person in my car, and we were going to turn left. And so he turned left, and I'm assuming it's okay. And I go to turn left, and there's a car coming. So there we had an accident. And basically this is the time when there's talk about seatbelts, but it wasn't that you had to wear one. And unfortunately, I didn't have a seatbelt on. So I had my head went forward into the dash, and I had a concussion. So it happened right by a hospital also, but they're having a strike at that hospital. So they had to take me to a different hospital. This happened in Edmonton, Alberta. Wow. And so there I was, all of a sudden I see all these people at the hospital coming to visit me. And I was only in there about a week. But at the time it took about a week before I was back home again. And I had to just, practice walking again. I mean, it wasn't a big deal. It was just kind of getting the motion of, just going out for walks and getting back into my speech was a little bit off and having to do that. But I finished university, but it took a bit longer at that particular year. And then it kind of changed the direction of what I was going to do following. I did get my degree, but it changed what I was going to do with that degree just because of the situation I was in. It basically took probably a good year really to be back into the swing of things. And there was no talk of epilepsy at that point. So I carry on, I decide, okay, I should be a teacher. So I go back to university, I was concerned about learning again, you know, getting to university and, you know, that's a lot of, so the first few courses I took in the summer, you know, spring and summer courses to kind of get ready for the new program I was in. And that was a little hard to do, but spring and summer always is a little hard. It's so crunched in, you know, only 3 weeks of course or so. And so then I took another one. Okay, that wasn't too bad. So I do take education. I got my degree in education, then became a teacher. So my specialty with my first degree was home ec. So then that's what I became a teacher for. And so that was 1980. I started teaching. And I got a job at a little town just north of Calgary. So that was really great. And teaching was fine. And I started the high school because that was grade 7 and 12. And then I went on to a middle school because they built a new school in that town. And I met my husband along the way. We decided to stay in Didsbury because I was teaching there. He was working in Calgary. And then about 19, so then the accident happened in 1977. In 1992, we were visiting my husband's parents in Edmonton. And that's when I had my first grandma seizure. There'd never been anything other than I had these little tiny episodes when I very first started teaching that you just have a moment where I'd be talking to people and then I would just, they didn't know where I went. I would just went off. But then things came back. So it wasn't anything major, just a little thing. But so 1992, we have this grandma seizure and that was in December of that year. So go to the hospital and get things all checked out. Well, of course, they had to come and get me, right? Because of having a seizure in the middle of the night. And so off I went to the hospital and they got things checked out. And then once I got back to Calgary, then we did further tests and discovered that's what was going on. I had epilepsy. So at the time, I didn't really know. I mean, I'd heard things about epilepsy, but not a lot. And you know, talking to the doctors and neurologists and all that, okay, they said, you should be fine. You should be able to go back to teaching, no problem. There should be nothing wrong with that. So I phoned my superintendent and I told her, this has happened, but I think I can't come back to school right yet. Well, just, it was close to Christmas, right? So I said, just take the time and then I'll be back in January. But they assured me that there should be no problems, that I should be fine with teaching and all that. So the medication then they prescribed for me was Tegretol, which now I have continued to take it ever since. And carbamazepine is what I take now as the generic version. And so as long as I have that, I haven't had any seizures since, other than I had a seizure about 1994. We were out in the sun watching a rodeo, and I think I forgot to take my medication that morning, and then I had a seizure there. And so then I knew, okay, do not forget to take that. Don't think that you don't need it. I've just been on it ever since, every morning, every night, ever since. So that's kept the seizures away and kind of thing. So, yeah.
Well, so in that area, I just had a quick question because in 94, I was in college and drinking a lot and I had seizures. I was on Tegretol, I was on Topamax. And was there any alcohol or any other lifestyle issues? Did you have any trouble sleeping or? Maybe you can add a little bit about that. Any stress going on, anything else?
No, and I know in the beginning there for many years, I made sure I did not go to bed past 12 midnight.
Sleeping is very important. You know, people don't realize it, but you need enough of sleep in your daily regimen in order to help you control your seizures. People who usually don't sleep enough, they tend to stress their body and that stress causes seizures. And it's funny when you talk about the 1990s, you know, that was one of the things that inspired me to write my first book was that in the 1990s, there was hardly any information about epilepsy. There might've been like four or five books on the bookshelf about epilepsy and they're written by doctors in medical terminology. And if you weren't a doctor, you had no clue what they were talking about because you didn't understand the medical terminology itself. And it was very hard. People, you know, a lot of people feared epilepsy because they didn't know anything about epilepsy. And there were a lot of people who suffered from epilepsy during that time and they kept it under the gun. And when I had written my book, when I was in college, I struggled with trying to get through college, the stresses of college, and trying to control my seizures. And at one point, I didn't know if I was able to complete college because I was having so many seizures. And it's when I wrote a letter into the Epilepsy Foundation. And, you know, back then, Google didn't come out till my junior year of college. But back then, I wrote a letter to the Epilepsy Foundation. I asked them to publish it. And I said, how do people, you know, I asked people to write their stories to me and give me advice on how they cope with epilepsy. I received hundreds of letters from all over the United States and Canada from people with epilepsy and how they cope with epilepsy. And they told me their stories. There were so many people out there. And to this day, there is still a stigmatism about epilepsy. It may not be as bad as it was before, but it's still pretty bad. People fear what they don't know. Unfortunately, if people don't understand it, they fear it. And they might not think of that person as equivalent. And that's what people with epilepsy think in their head. So a lot of people keep it quiet. And, you know, it wasn't until later on when I started talking about it. And, you know, the Epilepsy Foundation reached out to me and they, you know, they asked for me to speak about it. And, you know, by speaking about it, I helped so many people because so many people, you know, had so many questions. They were so scared. They were afraid to talk about it. They wanted everybody to think of them as just the other Joe. You know, they didn't want to be thought of as differently. They didn't want people to treat them differently. A lot of people had a lot of anger, like, why is this happening to me? You know, and then, you know, there was a lot of people who were very depressed about it because, you know, a lot of people got their license taken away from them. People lost their jobs. I lost my job because a producer saw me have a seizure and I fell to the floor and had a grand mal seizure. So, you know, it was very hard for people with epilepsy. And to this day, people with epilepsy struggle coping with epilepsy. And that, you know, that's an issue that we really have to keep in mind. We have come a long way, but there's still a long way to go. And it's teaching people how to cope with epilepsy. And how would you say, you know, when you had your seizures, you know, it must have been very, you know, after a seizure, it must be very upsetting. I know when I would have a seizure, especially when I was doing well, I would get very upset because as silly as it may sound, when you're doing well and you're not having seizures, you sometimes forget that you have epilepsy. You feel like the quote unquote normal person, you know, and then all of a sudden you have a seizure and you realize, wow, you know this in the back of your head, but it like reality sets in and you're like, wow, I have epilepsy. It's not going away. And emotionally, it can be very upsetting for a person because it's frustrating because we're powerless. We don't have, we don't have control of our disorder, but through natural healing and through taking care of yourself healthy and through maybe not drinking alcohol or being responsible about it or, you know, and putting the right foods in your body, people could help control their seizures. Now, when you were having seizures, did you change anything about the way you were living or sleeping or doing things differently that may have helped you get controlled and do as well as you are today? Do you have like a lifestyle, like a certain way you live life? Do you know your limitations, things you can't do and things you can't, you cannot do?
Well, the day before that first seizure happened at nighttime there, when I visit with my mother-in-law, we have a good visit. We drink a lot of coffee. I watch how much coffee I have. We probably had a whole pot between the two of us. And at home, I'd do that too, say on the weekend, you put on the coffee and you keep drinking coffee till it's all gone. So I don't do that anymore. And also,
I was saying, I got my coffee right here.
I know.
But not too much, just like, one a day.
two cups a day is about all. And also I was taking a cold medicine because I had a cold at the time. So I'm really careful about, if you've got a cold coming on, what you're taking and what you're mixing.
Especially, sorry to interrupt, but especially because I've been sober 10 years, NyQuil has 10% alcohol and people don't know that. And they're doing shots at night. And did you know that? It's like you had to read the labels. I learned in AA.
No, I didn't realize that. But when I did, I can't take NyQuil because when I did take NyQuil one time when I was sick, I was out cold literally for 2 days. I couldn't get out of bed. I was so out of it from the NyQuil. So
like
I never take
one shot.
Wow.
Yeah, but I'm sorry. But yeah, the alcohol adds to that. So maybe that could have been part of it.
Yeah.
But go back on your story there.
Yes. Yes. So I think the combination of those things that day, they just kind of triggered because I had nothing really to indicate anything before that.
Yeah.
And so it just came together and boom, I had. And so, and to me, I didn't really experience anything. It's my husband who, you know, he was the one who saw what was going on and everything. So I didn't really, to me, I don't even know, you know.
In the journals, in the medical journals, it is documented that too much coffee can trigger. It could be a trigger point for a seizure because you're putting so much caffeine in your body and you're stimulating your brain so much that it could trigger a seizure,
right?
Too much coffee. Yeah. So,
yeah.
You know, people who are coffee lovers need to drink coffee responsibly. Like it's, you can't have coffee if you have epilepsy. It's just, you have to be careful how much you have. Yeah, it's moderation, you know?
Yeah,
that's a part of it too. This is all connected. The coffee, so I have one a day and it's normal. It's like every 5-6 days I'm having coffee. I get sleep. Everything's normal. My lifestyle as an alcoholic was actually normal. It was routine is what I'm saying. I was drinking every night. And then if I stopped drinking for a day or two, I would have seizures. It was really weird. Like any type of lifestyle change.
Well, the stress of withdrawal.
Yeah.
You know, it's the stress of withdrawal. Your body is coming off the alcohol. Your alcohol, it gives you, you know, it helps you release all the stress and the tension. And then you're kind of in a comatose mode. And then all of a sudden, as the alcohol is releasing from your body, you're starting to get back into reality again. All those problems that you were trying to run away from, all those things that, you know, that you didn't want to cope with became reality once the alcohol released from your system and you were back to the real world. So, you know, it's, that could cause a seizure in itself, just the withdrawal of alcohol for many reasons, you know, definitely.
And Cheryl, back on your part of it too. So anything else that was going on at that time?
When I got the first seizure?
Yeah, like any other lifestyle changes you noticed?
Oh,
or
okay. Oh, changes. Okay. So, so then because of this had happened, and you know, you kind of think, well, is there anything else? Like, am I fine or can I still teach or whatever? Anyway, they also at the time, you know, you're getting testing done and you're getting all the little prodding going on and
the EEGs.
The CAT scans,
yeah.
And they found a cyst on my brain. And I think because of the epilepsy too, the neurologist didn't want me to drive. Said, you can't drive in your condition, you know. So we were living on acreage at the time. Yeah, that was just outside of Pittsburgh. And so I was lucky that in our area, a teacher that was at my school, he also lived in that same area. So then I got a ride with him most days. Other days I had the handy bus actually came for me. So I knew the fellow that drove the handy bus, he was the dad of my daughter's friend. And so he said, you know what, you qualify that you can take the handy bus. Oh, okay. So I did that on Mondays. He come down to the acreage, pick me up, take me to school. It was only 5 minutes actually from town. Kind of thing. So
right.
We did that. But then I was a home ec teacher. So I was doing sewing classes as well as foods classes. I needed to buy groceries for my classes. So I would go to the store, and the store wasn't that far away, but I could walk down to where the store was. But then bringing groceries back, I'd take the grocery cart down the sidewalk back to the school with my groceries. I didn't really like that. You know, but it worked. I could do it. That was okay. That was a solution. And then I would get some boys to take it back for me. And I'd say, you know, come back after school. I'll give you a little snack or something. Or some little treat for taking the cart back to the store for me. So there was different things like that that had to change, that sort of thing. And I don't know for sure if the medication, you know, you'd think, of course, the medication is going to change you a little bit. My emotions were, a little harder maybe to control. If you get frustrated about something in the classroom, it wasn't as easy to control.
Some medications can do that. That could be a side effect. Mood, you know.
Combination. This is a new thing for me. I have some new things I have to get used to. And I was, you know, you get frustrated easily. Yeah. So, and I was teaching grades 7 and 8. So
that's a tough grade to teach. Yeah. They that know it all.
It, right? So after 2 years of doing that, between talking to the administration and me, I thought, you know, I don't know for sure if this is going to change or how this is going to go on for me, you know. So I took a break from teaching.
And that had to be very hard too, you know, that, you're doing something that you enjoy and then, you know, your epilepsy and taking these medications is causing you stress in your life and changing your life a way that you don't want it to change. And you have to give up some of the things you love. And that's really hard, you know, dealing with that is very hard. You know, I had to give up things that I loved in life because of my epilepsy. And it was very hard because, and that's where I think a lot of people where the anger sets in and the depression and the sadness and the frustration. And I didn't drive for 15 years, you know, like when my seizures weren't controlled, you know, they asked me to please stop driving until they could control my seizures. And I stopped driving for 15 years. And I don't know how you felt, but I kind of felt imprisoned in my own home, even though I had people around me willing to help me and take me places. I hated to ask for help. I hated to say, can you take me to the grocery store? Can you do this for me? I need to go to the doctors, you know, because I just felt like I was being an inconvenience. These people around me loved me and didn't care. They wanted to help, but in my own mind, I felt like I was being an inconvenience and I felt imprisoned in my own home in a sense. That was hard for me.
And some independence is taken away there. You can't just go, you know, you have to arrange it and whatever. So living on the acreage, we decided that we were going to move into town because I still couldn't drive.
Right.
And so we actually built a house right in town. That was fun to be building our own house and all that type of thing.
Yeah.
And we're just in the middle of doing that when I decided I'm going to take a break from teaching. So anyway, so we're going to do that. And then people started asking me if I would sub for them. And because of living where we were right close to all the schools. So that was good. I did everything from kindergarten to grade 12.
Right.
So by doing that, it was good because later in life, as they moved along in education various ways, I had all this experience that I had gathered because I was doing kindergarten. I was doing grade 12 chemistry. I was doing everything.
Right. Yeah.
So that turned out to be a good
thing. That's wonderful. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So, you know, like you say, you something comes along, but this is a good thing now that we, you know, that never would have happened otherwise kind of thing. So you just make that, you know,
that's how I kind of look at things too. It's like, you know, something might not go your way or something might be taken away from you, but I feel like there's always I feel like everything happens for a reason and, you know, things tend to work itself through and then, you know, there's always a rainbow at the end of the path, you know, and sometimes working, you know, like the pathway might not be so easy. It's, you know, it's a journey down. But I feel like everything happens for a reason and things kind of pan out to, you know, and work out at the end, you know, and look at you.
All those obstacles in life, I say the obstacles in the mirror are farther away than they appear.
Yeah.
So that little thing that on our mirrors that says something about that objects in mirror, but these obstacles sometimes remain in our head. And a lot of that's that fear we always discuss about epilepsy and epileptics having, oh my gosh, I'm driving again. Even when you get your license back, I lost mine for multiple times in years. I had 2 epileptic car accidents in 1 year and I was an alcoholic, you know, and I had 2 DUIs. So it was a combination of, I can't drive. Well, the alcohol instilled, I'll show you, you know, I can still drive. And I was driving
with
a license and I got pulled over from an accident that I caused from my epilepsy, not alcohol related, but seizures.
Right.
Yeah.
Blowing on a breathalyzer. And 0.0, and the sheriff said, I'll never forget this. He says, oh, you're not, you know, and I said, I have epilepsy. He goes, that's worse than 5 DUIs. He goes, "You're screwed." He said, "You're not getting your license back. Why are you driving right now?" He was pissed. And it was people that were like, "He's drunk." They were yelling at me, and it was in the day, but I wasn't, you know, it was the epilepsy and what people go through. I can just, we all can completely understand, right?
Oh yeah. You know, and especially when people don't get it, you know, when people don't understand what epilepsy is, you know, it's terrible, you know, you know, I don't even remember, like, when you tell people that you have epilepsy, they have that look of empathy in their eyes. And that's like the worst feeling in the world, you know, not being able to drive was, I think that was one of the biggest challenges I went through life. Is those 15 years were so hard for me. I can't even imagine going through that again. You know, that's when I wrote all my books, because that was, you know, I started writing, I started doing freelance. I created my website. You know, I was reaching out. I had a lot of time on my hands. I had my three kids. Nap time, I ran to the computer and I was typing away. I created my businesses from home. So, you know, I wanted to work in the big corporate world, but I ended up, you know, working from home and still doing things I loved and raising three children at the same time. But it was it's very hard when you get your independence taken away from you, or feels like you've gotten your independence taken away from you when you can't drive, you know. So I could feel for people when they'd say they got their license taken away, because it's terrible to, you know, not live life the way there's a difference between reality and fantasy. And everyone has a fantasy and a desire and that we paint in our head that we would love to live this life. And then we have reality where we can't, you know, life doesn't really pan out to be exactly like those fantasies we put in our brain. And, you know, it's understanding the difference between reality and fantasy, and, you know, we come into terms that, yes, I have epilepsy. Yes, I can't do everything that, you know, I always wanted to do, but I am blessed because I can breathe. I get up every morning, I breathe the air around me. I, you know, I have three beautiful children, and I did make a career for myself, and I did lots of other things and met lots of other people. So you have to always look at the positive. And I feel that's how we get through life. Is the only way to survive with epilepsy is the power of positive thinking, you know, and positive.
That's what Cheryl said too, before we started recording here. Cheryl, maybe you can go into that and say a little bit about what happened, kind of wrap it up in a sense, but to say how the power of positive thinking helped you, or just tell us a little bit more and to roll into your new book too that you have.
Well, I wasn't going to let it hold me back. One thing about doing the substitute teaching, it gave me the realization that I could do just about anything. It gave me a chance to try all kinds of new things. Every time you went into the classroom, it was something new for you. So you knew that I can do this. And also at the time, the newspaper in our town asked me if I would do a little column in there about, you know, what people should be eating. Because at the time it was like, okay, we're not supposed to eat eggs, and we're not supposed to eat butter, and we reduce our sugar. So then I had this idea, okay, so now what's to eat? So I wrote this little book, but I had a little column in the paper. And from that, then I got the idea, I've done all this writing for the paper, I can put all that together in this little book. So then I did this little book, and I thought, oh, this would be a nice little book to maybe the bookstore would be interested. So in town, that was good, you know. And then I approached the Kohl's bookstore at the time, now they're Indigo. So I asked them and said, well, for us to have the book in our store, you have to get it, get something done, like say through the newspaper, to have a little article to talk about it. Oh, okay, I'll do that. So I approached them, so sure, we'll do that. Now, at that time, when was that? That was about 90, 95, you know, the late 90s. And so that's how you did things, you know. You don't have the internet, and everything is just so much different now. And so, okay, well, that's how you do it. So that's what we did. And then from there, well, that I didn't get into any more writing after that. But then when we decided we moved to Calgary, because that's where my husband lived. So we moved to Calgary in 99. And then I answered a little ad for somebody who was looking for a tutor at their new learning center. I thought, well, that would be a good thing to do. So I go to the interview, and I had a little bit of business experience in my resume because I always did something to do with sewing. I had sewing classes. I did sewing like wedding dresses and grad dresses and things like that. And so they could say, well, you've got some business experience. How would you like to be the director of our learning center? Like, oh my goodness. Okay, sure, I'll do that. So it seems like whenever somebody is putting a challenge in front of me, I'm saying, yes, certainly I can do that. I don't know for sure how it's going to turn out, but I will, sure. If you're kind of, it's almost like they're not too sure what to do. They're kind of like grasping at straws, trying to find somebody to help them with a solution. I'm thinking, whatever I do for them is going to be great, because right now they don't have anything. So now I can
right.
go in there and help them out. So that's what we did. So I was the director of this learning center. And that's when our friend, he had decided to take on some financial advising, because he saw that when he finished teaching, that's what he could continue doing. So then through him, I got some ideas about, there must be something different that we can be doing with how we are spending money on groceries. So that's how that all got started. And so he says to me, Cheryl, can you just find an extra $100 that you can put a little extra towards the RSPs that I'm arranging for you and your husband? That's our retirement fund money. And so, okay, well, let's see if I can do this. So I thought, well, I had a whole math background. Surely I can figure out something a little bit different about groceries. So then I went about devising a plan. I spent a lot of time in the grocery store, you know, looking at prices and testing out these ideas I had for plans. And the people I worked with at the learning center, I'd say, what do you think about this idea? Could you follow this as a person who's not a home ed person? Does this make sense to you? So it took a long time of doing all that research. And along the way, because of doing the, finding the ways to save money at the grocery store, you're getting healthier because you're not buying the chips and the pot, and you're finding a different way to create healthy meals for your family. So we had two daughters, and also testing things out on them. Do they like this type of a recipe? Is this a good thing? We're not just going to have spaghetti every Thursday night, macaroni every Wednesday night, because that was the daughter's favorites, you know, type of thing. And for me, I had seen a lot of meal plans and things done in magazines, but I never liked any of them. And I guess I don't always like to follow somebody else's idea. I like to come up with my own idea. And so I figured out a plan that I could follow. I was a busy mom. I was directing the learning center. Some evenings I need to stay there. Sometimes we just had to have a plan in place that the girls and my husband could put the meal together. And so mm-hmm. we did a lot of leftovers, and that took a long time of getting my husband to come around to leftovers are good. Now he's great with them. He's just looking for the leftovers, you know? And so we've continued this plan ever since I came up with that. And the daughters, they were living on their own, and so they're following that as well. So of course you need to bring in the nutrition into your plan. So it has to have some nutrition guidelines that people could understand. And you've got a plan, okay, this is how you can build your plan from that. And this is how you build your grocery list from that. This is what you do when you're in the grocery store. So I had all these elements that I wanted to bring together into this plan. So that's why I wanted to make sure it wasn't too confusing. So that's why I asked a lot of questions of people, what do you think? And also the idea of the money that you save from the groceries, it's going to be your retirement plan down the road. And so I wanted to show them, if you save this money, if you invest it over time, it's going to become this. And so that's what will help you stick with the plan. I want an easy plan, but also I know people, I know me, that if it's not easy, you're not going to follow it on a consistent basis. So that was the premise of what I was doing. So I talked a lot to nutritionists, and do they approve of my idea? You know, I'm going to have from up top, from people that work with it all the time. Does this make sense to you? And then I wanted to talk to financial people. Is this right to you? My idea of what's going to happen with compound interest. We're going to start with this amount of money at this percent of interest. And of course, that all fluctuates too. like I started writing this in 2002. That was my first year writing a plan. And everything kept happening. And every time I heard something in the news, things that are happening down in the States, you had it happen sort of 2008 or so. And then we started having things happen to us as well. And I've got to get that book out. I've got to hurry up. Well, I never did actually get it finished until 2 years later. And then still, I took it to the newspaper to get a review done. And she said, hey, this is a really good idea, Cheryl, but this is how you need to write a book.
Oh, wow.
This is not yet in the format that you need to write about. Oh, no. Oh, dear. Okay. So then I mentioned to my sister, said, well, I can help you do that. Oh, I didn't know you knew how to do that. So she helped me with all the formatting and all that type of thing. And then finally, in 2015 was when it was actually in a format that was a book. And so then it was, I was able to sell it in some of the bookstores.
Excellent.
But I thought, this has to go bigger. This is a really big thing that I need to get going. So that's still kind of at that point where, and like you say, over when you've got some time, then you write a book. So over the COVID time, a lot of people were writing books and putting out digital books, audio books, lots of audio books, all that type of thing. So there's a lot of competition out there for books. So it's, and it's amazing what you find out about the different things that people are doing, how they're doing, the different connections you make. I've made a connection with a fellow that he does the, he does commercials. And so his voice is like, they really like it when he does commercials, or he does, he's the narrator for an audiobook. And so you learn about that whole audiobook world out there. So yeah, it's amazing the different people that you meet and what you learn from them.
And your persistence too. I commend you on that, because I've done that from 2005. I started my first one and still never technically published my first one, but got published in another one. But I still want to put out Barstool Knowledge, I call it. And I finished it, but I know what you mean. Like 7 years it took me. I just thought, I'm picturing somebody writing a book and you sit down and you write it. And Wayne Dyer said that one time, he wrote a book in 13 days. Erroneous Zones. I love him. He's one of my inspirations. And he goes, I went to a cabin and I wrote it in 13 days. But you know, he says usually it took a year to 2 years to write a book. And that makes sense to me. But it was taking me 5 years because I really didn't have a plan. I didn't know what was going on. I was just like, that sounds good in writing. So we have to have a plan. And that's what your inspiration now, because you're getting, you published it. You want to get it out there. That's why you're here, to tell people about it. And I love the fact that you're helping people save money. But also, I was going to bring up this fact about Sprouts, they call it here, and other stores that are health food, health conscious. I'm going to spend more money there, but the food's going to last longer and it's going to be healthier, right? Instead of buying the cereals and all the things that are in the center of the store, they say the frozen, yes, section, you know, you want to shop out here in the vegetables and the produce,
yes,
section, right?
Oh, definitely. You know, it's so important that you eat healthy. And if you could figure out a way where you could eat healthy and also be able to do it in an effective way, you know, monetarily, is even better. Because, you know, I get upset because, you know, whatever we put in our body has an effect on our health. And, you know, when you try to eat healthy, if you notice when you go to the food store, the healthy food is through the roof. And if you want to buy organic, it's through the roof. So how are people supposed to be, how are they supposed to be healthy when the prices are so high and costly, you know, and it makes it hard to be healthy, you know, and especially with people with epilepsy and any disease or disorder, or even people, you know, in general, you know, everything we put on our body has a toll on our body. If our body doesn't know what it is, it stores it. And if it's toxic or has toxic or artificial ingredients in it, it's getting stored and it's making our organs sluggish. And then we become sluggish, and then we become fatigued, sick, stressed, and don't understand why these things are happening. So, you know, the food industry really needs to take a step up too and make it easier for people to be healthy, you know. And it's great that you're writing this book, because you're teaching people how they can be healthy in a cost-effective way. And I love that.
Yeah, it's it. And because of the way the economy is right now, that's why it's sort of giving me more impetus to do something this summer. On a summer break, it gives me more time to kind of get that going. because right now it's, you know, every day in the news we're hearing about what the inflation is, the gas prices are affecting the price of the groceries because it costs more to get them there. The gas has come down a little bit for us around here, but it's still pretty high.
Right.
And, you know, it's like even me, when I first started this plant, I had to change what I was doing about buying groceries. I used to go to the store and we pick up these things that we needed. I need some chicken. I get a variety of meats and I get, you know, the produce. Like I always was very mindful of all the great fresh fruits and vegetables. Mm-hmm. And, you know, eating lots of those, making lots of salads and stir fries and all kinds of different combinations of meats with vegetables and all that kind of thing. I do still eat meat. I'm probably never going to be a vegetarian sadly, but I am. We really are mindful about eating less meat. We don't need that much meat. And
no.
So there's, you know, that was one thing I wanted to show. There's ways of using meat that you don't have to have a lot of it.
You know, no, you don't have to have a lot of it at all.
And I mean, what fits in your hand, that's all you need.
That's all you need. You know, if you look at the normal portion size, Weight Watchers is a great example of showing you what your portion size is supposed to be. And that's the healthy portion sizes that we're supposed to have. We're supposed to have about this much of our fruits and vegetables, this much of our, you know, our entree, which would be either, you know, whatever you're eating, either with the pasta or you're eating the chicken or the fish or whatever, you know, but we're supposed to have small portions, you know, and if you go to Europe, you'll see what the small portions are. I remember when I went to France and they gave us our dinner and I looked down, I'm like, is this really supposed to fill me up? I'm like, you know, because you're so used to the American, you know, like the amount of food they give you in restaurants in America versus in Europe.
Sure.
But I'll tell you, the food was fresh. And when the food is fresh, I got full off those small portions. I didn't need anything. And the difference is that fresh food has a different effect on your body than regular food that is either processed, like the you know, processed pasta versus the fresh pasta, the tomatoes that are, you know, freshly grown, picked off, you know, the vine versus, you know, the tomatoes that have been, you know, infused with different chemicals. So they're bigger and plumper and redder.
You're not everything, right? Your body's, your mind and your body are connected and they say you need these things. And when you eat all those carbs and those fast foods, you get maybe one or two of those five or six things. And your body's still, I'm hungry, because you're missing something.
And
it's not saying, but then we eat more carbs and we eat more food.
Yeah.
And real quick, I had a friend 3 years ago that I helped get healthy again. And he wasn't even, it wasn't drugs or alcohol. It was just his lifestyle. So we go shopping and I say, let's go to Sprouts. And he goes, that costs too much. I'm like, okay. So he goes to Food for Less and it's just a basic store. What does he do? He goes right down the middle aisle. And it was like a flashback of me in college. And I'm sitting there watching him go frozen food. He's just a robot. And I was like, what is going on? The whole cart was full of frozen food, canned food, and all this crap.
And it's all processed. You know, people don't get that. It's all processed.
It's only 100. If it's under $100, I'm fine. I'm like, okay.
You know, it's the sugar content and the carbs that kill you, you know, and I always say, like, if you look at the ingredients and you can't say the word, then obviously it's not good for you. And the more words you see that you can't pronounce, the worse it is for you and the more reason to stay away from it. And a lot of foods have such high sugar contents and that sugar is addictive. And, you know, it's like when you wean off of sugar, it's like an alcohol addiction. You go through a withdrawal. You know, the same thing.
Yeah. I was shopping the other evening. I went to the store to get something. We're lucky where I live in Chilliwack. Everything is fairly close to where I am. And I'm in the checkout line and I'm watching these young boys had gone into the store. They're together, like three or four of them. They're about 17 or 18 years old. And I'm thinking, well, maybe we have a campus, university campus in here. Mm-hmm. And maybe they're doing a summer course or something, or maybe they're going on a camping trip. I don't know what exactly they're doing. But anyway, so I looked. I don't always look. I used to, when I was writing the book, I always looked at what people had in their cart. I wanted to see, well, what kind of combination of groceries are they buying? So these fellows, they had all their food on the little conveyor belt there, and they had a stack of those frozen meals. Those little tiny ones that...
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And it was a huge, Oh, yeah. And then just have a few other things. They say that was what they needed for their dinner. I know my dad was.
Don't forget the beer. Probably beer too.
Yeah. You know, quite often you hear the stories about when a couple of guys are, you're batching together for a couple of years or something, and they have a lot of craft dinner at their house.
Yeah. But you know what? For my epilepsy, my seizures got better when I ate healthier. When I started eating healthier and I started detoxing my body and I started taking vitamins and supplements and, you know, doing it on a regular basis, my seizures actually got, you know, less and less and less. And then I became controlled. You know, your body really takes a toll on what you put in it, you know. And I think it's great that you're teaching people how to eat healthy and how to do it in a constructive way where it's not going to put, you know, blow out your bank account through the roof, you know.
Yeah, I love that. And let us know your contact information too. So kind of in wrapping up here, just tell everybody about your book and the best contact information. If you have a website or email address, what's the best way to get a hold of you?
Oh, well, I do have an Instagram page. And so that's a good way to get to the page. And then there's all kinds of different postings that I have there. And what's it, I've got people that have been doing reviews lately for me and that kind of thing. And oh, right the there is where you can
let people know about your Instagram page though. What's it called?
Okay.
The name of it?
So it's called Found Health Wealth Time.
Found Health Wealth Time. Okay, I'll put a link on here too to that.
Found Health Wealth. My book is actually called Found Health Wealth and Time in a Grocery Bag. But that's a little long to have for anyone. I had to shorten it up. But yeah, and so right there, and then there's a one of the link tree to show, okay, you go right in there, and then you can get to the various places where you can order the book. So it's fairly easy. It's easy to do, but you know, it's one of those things that you just have to, it's this little tiny mouse amongst huge giant kingdom of animals or something.
Yeah.
The mouse that ate the peas.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, thank you, Cheryl. And no, anything
it's been
else?
Very nice talking to you.
Yes.
You know, pulling up all those different factors of my my history. One thing I was going to mention, we're talking about vitamins and that sort of thing, and I didn't know this when I was first on the Tegretol, and I didn't find out until just a few years ago, but the Tegretol or carbamazepine, it sort of gets in the way of absorbing vitamin D in the body.
Yes, you should always have take vitamin D, zinc, vitamin C. Yeah, and then if you can take ginseng, I would take ginseng for your energy level, just to increase your energy. And, you know, I always suggest Biome. Biome is a great company. I keep it on my website because I just love it. And it has all the reds and greens, and it has probiotics, and it has prebiotics in it. And that helps boost your energy level. And that helps also cleanse your body, get all those toxins out of your body. And because a lot of those seizure medications actually make a lot of people feel fatigue. So you want to be able to, you know, take things that will help, you know, vitamins that will help boost your energy level, or supplements that will boost your energy level and give you a little bit of a kickstart. And even matcha tea. Matcha tea is great. Matcha tea actually helped decrease my urge to want to drink coffee. And it also boosts the metabolism and gives you energy. It has green beans instead of coffee beans, which is a little bit healthier for you. And it's healthy for the body. It detoxes the body and it does a lot of good stuff for you. And it also gives you that energy that you need. You know, so it has a lot of good things also. So, because I know people with epilepsy, that's one thing, those medications can make you feel very tired and sluggish, you know, and that's why people, I think, drink so much coffee, especially when you have epilepsy, because you, you know, that medicine can really, you know, drag your energy level down.
Yeah.
All those different meds.
There, do your research too. We have our phone in our hand every time. And I became kind of addicted about 7 years ago in sobriety. I was like negative effects of, and I'd look up those ingredients you're talking about, Stacey, that I couldn't pronounce. And I had to like type it in. I couldn't even pronounce it. And I would see, oh, this causes this disease, this cancer, this. You can lose your teeth. You can, I'm like, why am I eating this? So do your research out there, everybody, about the foods you're eating. If they're over 7 ingredients, you can't pronounce the ingredients, you know, eat healthy. And a lot of what we're talking about here adds up to it, because also negative effects of Tegretol, negative effects of Tokmax. Know what's not getting in your body. Like you said, vitamin D. I had to do a lot of research even when I was taking it. I had to go to the library sometimes because I was like, what's going on with this? I don't feel comfortable with Tokmax or Lamictal. Mm-hmm. There's so many side effects. So now we have it all in our hand on our cell phone. So no excuses, right?
I say be your own doctor, you know, like my doctor used to love it because I used to come in with a list of questions and, you know, I'd have my calendar book, my list of questions, you know, and I would go through everything with him. I would, you know, and you have to be your own doctor. You can't just rely on your doctor to have all the answers. You know, he takes care of your epilepsy or she takes care of your epilepsy, but you also have to educate yourself, what you're taking, what you're putting in your body, your lifestyle, you know, and you have to incorporate it all. And then if you have questions, don't be afraid to communicate with your doctor. That's another important factor. A lot of people with epilepsy don't have good communications with their doctors, but that's the only way you'll get better. You know, people say, well, my doctor doesn't understand because she doesn't have epilepsy. No, they don't, but they understand the medical part. So if you're able to explain to them how you feel from a patient perspective and you can communicate well with your doctor, you could work together as a team, and that could help your epilepsy as all also.
Love it. Well, thanks again, Cheryl, for everything you've done and are doing. We'll have you on again too, because Liz wants to have you on there. She apologizes she couldn't be here today, but you know, we all get busy in life. So we'll have you on again and talk a little bit more about your book and the next steps you're taking to get it out there.
Thanks very much. It's been very good to have a chance to talk. I really like that. The conversation we're having is really good. Super.
Yeah, it made me think of a quote I have is turn the impatient to I'm patient, the imbalanced to I'm balanced, the impractical to I'm practical, and the imbalance basically are the impossible to I'm possible.
So I like that.
A little bit differently, and don't be worried about, you know, everything happens for a reason. If we go through it, we grow through it.
Yes.
And part of it is I'm not just one body. I'm not just nobody. I'm not just anybody. I'm not just like anybody. I'm somebody. I'm the one body that matters most. So pay attention to your own body out there.
100%. Your body is always giving you signals. Before we go, just, you know, people don't listen to their body, but if you pay attention to what your body's trying to tell you, you'll see, you know, all those signals, like feeling tired, this, that, anything, you know, your body is always telling you, you know, and giving you hints, you know, so listen to your body, listen to what it's trying to tell you, and then try to do things to fulfill what those needs and what your body's telling you, because everything that you go through is a signal from your body saying, hey, I'm not feeling 100%, you know, and it gives you the signals, and then you have to try to do things to make your body feel better. So if you feel in fatigue, then you have to figure a way how to not make yourself fatigue. Maybe you need to change your diet. Maybe you need to get more sleep. Maybe you need to incorporate some vitamins and supplements, but always listen to your body, because your body is always giving you signals and telling you things.
Exactly. Love it. We're going to wrap up here. All the contact information will be below on here on the video. For Stacy, for Liz, and everyone that is partaking in this. So again, we thank you and have a great day, everyone.
Have a great day.
Yeah, you too. Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
Bye.